actually have a lot of seniority.
She's on. We're good. We're on. I'd like to welcome everyone this afternoon and thank you for everyone's indulgence holding this meeting off the floor to today's Senate Standing Committee on Codes. This day, Tuesday, May 9th, 2017. As always, we are joined by my good friend and colleague, the ranking member of the committee, Senator Squadron, our vice chair, Senator Savino. We're also joined by Senators O'Mara, Kaminsky, Boyle, Krueger, Peralta, Tedisco, Hoylman, Akshar, and Croce. Did I miss anyone? I have not. If there are no opening questions or conversation, let's go right to the agenda. The first bill is print number 64, Senator Young.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to establishing the crimes of failure to register or verify as a domestic abuse offender in the first and second degrees, to amend the correction law in relation to enacting Danielle de Medici, Jessica Tush, and Brittany Pasalacqua's law, and to amend the criminal procedure law in relation to domestic abuse offenders.
Questions, comments? Senator Squadron.
Thank you, and you know, I know that this is the first of, I think, three different bills that address this very serious issue that have been worked on a long time, and of course, I think every one of us at this table, whatever party we're in, knows just what an important issue this is, just how tragic it is when people are victimized by domestic violence, and it destroys lives and communities at the same time. In fact, I've worked to pass aggravated family offense legislation through an omnibus bipartisan anti-domestic violence bill in 2012 that had a number of components of different bills. Many people had carried to create a category for repeat domestic violence offenders, like someone in my district who ended up after dozens of offenses killing a police officer responding to a complaint. So it's a critically important issue. We have to get it right, though, because we know that in dealing with this issue, we need to be protecting victims' anonymity, and ensuring that when we're talking about going after and stopping domestic violence offenders, they're certainly domestic violence offenders. This bill is an improvement over bills that I've had concerns with for many years that purported to focus on domestic violence, but in fact were felony offense registries, permanent felony offense registries in the state of New York, something that I think has no precedent anywhere. The narrowing of the bill in this version is appreciated. However, it doesn't track, for example, the aggravated family offense legislation. I think there are still legitimate questions as to, from the perspective of victims, what the best offenses to include are, and from the perspective of stopping offenders and punishing offenders so they can't do it again, what the best way to do that is. So on this bill, and I won't speak on each of the three, and the other two, I'll vote without rec. I do think that after sort of this period of time, I appreciate that the way the chair is dealing with it this year as opposed to prior years is to put a number of options on the agenda. I think that this issue, after so much time, and we know it hasn't had passage in the assembly, may be due for a real hearing. Bringing everyone together, figure out what the best proven way is to crack down on the scourge and to honor the memory of the victims for whom the bill is named. So I'm without rec on this bill and the subsequent similar bills.
Thank you very much for those comments, Senator Squadron. In fact, I'll be voting without rec on this bill as well. Are there any other questions or comments? Senator Krueger.
I also, just to reiterate, perhaps more passionate about why I'm voting no on these two bills plus the third bill later on in the agenda. In 2010, I was just reminded we did a roundtable with experts in domestic violence, the Attorney General's office, and the Immigration Justice experts who pointed out that these bills would actually not accomplish our goals to identify and decrease risk of domestic violence, but in fact, some of the unintended consequences of these kinds of registries is actually the exact reverse. And it is the danger of making people believe that the risk is not there. But in fact, the assignment needs to be a prevention before we ever face the issues of you're convicted, and then we put you on the registry. The third bill, so I will not continue on for why I disagree with you actually decrease the value of the information, but you also, again, leave an illusion that you're doing something to prevent the crimes from happening, and don't redirect the public and our criminal justice system is doing everything we can to prevent. And in fact, if prevention does not work, appropriate prosecution, but after the fact, lists upon lists upon lists is not the way we're going to protect our society. So I am also, like my colleague, hoping that we will ask the hard questions in a room, perhaps this room, with a universe of people who work in the field and learn what has actually been successful and not successful in other places.
Thank you, Senator Krugman. Any other questions or comments? Why don't we move to a vote? All those in favor?
Aye.
Against? Senator Krueger, Senator Hoylman, Senator Kaminsky, Senator Squadron, myself, without rec. The bill is referred to finance. Next is a related bill, print. Before I get to that, Senator Squadron had a question about a bill on the last codes committee agenda. It was bill S3716, Senator DeFrancisco, related to possession of firearms on property owned by or held in trust for SUNY. Senator Squadron had a very good question. He wanted to know if SUNY was aware of the bill. And in fact, we reached out to the sponsor's office. And not only aware of it, but SUNY ESF requested the change to restore Hunter to these lands. So I just wanted to get that information to you.
Thank you very much. And I will sleep easier tonight as well. No, but that's really, I really appreciate the follow-up, and that'll really inform votes on the floor. So thank you.
Okay. So next, print number 6-5, Senator Young.
An act to amend the penal law and the correction law in relation to establishing Brittany's law.
Questions, comments? It's related. Same, I'm sure, same sentiments as the last bill. Mm-hmm. All those in favor? Opposed? Senator Krueger, Senator Hoylman, without rec, Senator Kaminsky, Senator Squadron, and myself. The bill is referred to finance. Next is print number 232, Senator Golden.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to increasing penalties for certain violent felonies.
Questions, comments, discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The bill is moved. Print number 294, Senator Robach.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to enhancing punishment for crimes involving domestic violence and to amend the criminal procedure law in relation to the consideration of certain factors when determining the issuance of an order of recognizance or bail.
Questions, comments, Senator Squadron.
So I noticed that there's a 10-year look-back provision here for violations, not misdemeanors, not felonies, not misdemeanors, but for violations themselves. Having passed a bill that creates a predicate offense that is a violation for potential jail time, a pedestrian and vulnerable road user safety bill that became law. I know that it can be very difficult for prosecutors to do a look back on violations, especially cross counties. Has that been sort of addressed or dealt with?
I'm not aware of the sponsor.
And then sort of the second question on this bill. It's a big, very, very big bill, by the way. This is the bill that does a whole lot. I noticed that it seems to create dangerousness as a factor for bail, which is been something under a great deal of discussion around bail reform. Am I reading the bill right there? And if so, I think that sort of within an omnibus bill, without discussion, you know, since bail reform is such a big issue, it's probably certainly not the right and best place to do this. So are we reading that right, the dangerous standard? And how would that work if that were true on one set of offenses in the state, but dangerousness didn't exist as sort of a much broader system, and we know it's incredibly complex to devise a dangerousness standard?
It does, simply with respect to offenses where it is alleged it's a member of the same family or household, then the different standard would apply.
So are there models, are we using that dangerous standard for bail on other offenses already in the state?
In the state of New York, the standard is risk of flight, and that is somewhat subjective. There are certain things that judges look toward with respect to making that assessment, and I would imagine here, while suggested, well, also subjective, that judges would be able to determine or make that assessment.
I mean, okay, dangerousness standard, there are proponents, there are opponents, there are concerns. It is a big, expensive standard. One thing we know for sure, it's a big, extensive standard to impose. You're asking a lot of judges who don't want it without guidance and objective standards. And to do it for one set of charges of aggravated harassment, looks like Senator Robach here is trying to deal with different harassment and family offense issues and create an entirely different structure around it without considering the consequences. So I think it's without rec, and I strongly urge members of the committee to be reluctant to ask our courts to create an entirely new bail standard for one subset of charges without guidance. I think we all agree that a thoughtful court and a thoughtful system is critically important to the execution of justice.
Well, I'm not speaking for the sponsor. I will say this. So in our state where risk of flight is the standard, judges routinely assess a myriad of factors which play into that risk, including, I will tell you daily, the dangerousness as they see it of a situation, the severity of the crime. While not specifically part of the standard, it is, I can tell you in practice, utilized when a judge makes that assessment. And I think what Senator Robach is trying to attempt to do here, and I agree with you that he's choosing this category to specifically use the dangerousness as one of those elements. I think he's trying to single out domestic violence due to the fact that the anatomy of many of these cases suggests that there is a certain dangerousness that exists in a way that is different from other types of crimes when assessing bail. Senator Kaminsky.
Thank you, Senator Lenz. I think domestic violence is also particularly different because a judge is making an assessment about whether an order is going to be respected or violated. So a judge is kind of doing two things in a domestic violence case, and if a judge doesn't have reason to believe that the order is going to be followed, then the judge has to take precaution. They give all types of warnings up and down. You've got to sign something in front of like six people. So I also believe what part of this law does is say that if you violate a stay away order, you're going to lose your bail. And I think trying to figure out whether that's going to happen or not certainly plays into it in domestic violence cases. I certainly get Senator Squadron's view of how this encroaches on the current system, but I do also think this flows naturally in this type of case, and those judgments definitely get made all the time anyway. I mean, we don't think judges are actually considering things based on dangerousness, that we're kidding ourselves, although I do think it's worth mentioning as a side that we should take up something about a system where the loss is one thing and the practice is another.
Right, and
thank you, Senator Kaminsky.
Sorry to jump in, but to be clear, I think that the conversation on bail reform is right, 100% right. I think this is a great example of why. In fact, the fact that when you even talk about domestic violence, we can't use it. I'm just saying that to create multiple systems around one bill is not the way to do it. It is this bill calls out for the urgent need for bail reform. In the meantime, without rec here, and I think it would be quite problematic for this to become law without the broader bail reform happening. But we do need bail reform. Goodness knows.
Thank you, Senator Squadron. This bill, I think Senator Robach is saying, is a good place to start. Are there any other questions or comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Without rec. Senator Krueger, Senator Squadron, Senator Hoylman, the bill is referred to finance. Next is print 311, Senator Robach.
An act to amend the criminal procedure law in relation to providing that persons arrested for domestic violence shall forfeit bail when violating an order of protection.
Questions, comments? All those in favor? Any opposed? Without rec. The bill is moved. Print 409, Senator Robach.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to elder abuse through social media.
Questions, comments? All those in favor? Any opposed? Without rec, the bill's moved. Senator Krueger, Senator Hoylman, without rec.
I'm actually without rec.
Senator Squadron, without rec.
I got behind you. Going so quickly.
907, Senator Amador.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to designating the sheriff of the County of Albany as a licensing officer for the purposes of firearms and authorizing the possession in the County of Albany of a pistol or revolver while attending a firearms familiarity, safety, loading, and firing course conducted by the office of the sheriff of such county and providing for the repeal of such provisions upon expiration thereof.
Questions, comments, Senator Squadron.
Thank you. And I do note this bill passed last year during what I call rules of palooza. So, you know, sometimes bills slip through there. As we have, I appreciate that we have the opportunity to see this in committee this year and discuss it a little bit. So I want to thank the chair for that. It's a great deal. And I believe we have a sponsor with us in spirit. So
we'll tell them what you said.
I appreciate it. This bill does a couple of different things. It makes the county sheriff the licensing officer, which I know is rare, but this wouldn't be the only county where that's true. It also changes where applicants are able to possess firearms, you know, in shooting ranges and stuff under the supervision of the sheriff, as I understand it. And then it has a third component, as I understand it, which is that it allows folks to possess pistols having filed for a permit, even if they have not yet received it, even if the background check, for example, has not been completed. Is that correct?
That is with the training provision, and that they could possess during the training that would be administered by the sheriff.
But only during the training and only under supervision.
Yes.
It is
yes.
not a broader.
And there is a they can't have there is a criminal history check to make sure that they don't have a.
Yeah. Well, just to be clear, it's only under literally under specific active supervision of the sheriff in person.
At a range
yeah.
on that site. Thank you very much. It's good that we ask questions.
Move the bill.
I appreciate it.
I'm voting against
Senator Hoyle.
I'm voting against it because I don't want Senator Hoyle getting angry. Move the bill.
It's already authorized in Suffolk County. Come on, do it. Essentially, it's the one county is authorized.
It is.
Without
so
distinction, move the bill.
Thank you, Senator Boyle, for that negative vote. without rec, Senators Krueger, Senator Hoylman in the negative.
I'm an aye.
And Senator Squadron in the negative.
I'm in the positive.
Oh, I'm sorry, in the positive. There we go. The bill is moved. 961, Senator Young.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to elevating the severity of the felony offense of killing a police work dog or police workhorse and establishing the Class E felony offense of injuring a police work dog or police workhorse.
Questions, comments?
Is this based on an incident?
It is.
It is. Okay, thank you.
Any other questions or comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The bill is moved. 1007, Senator Robach.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to creating the crime of environmental damage to property.
Questions, comments?
Move the bill.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Without rec? The bill is moved. 1107, Senator Young.
An act to amend the penal law and the correction law in relation to enacting the Domestic Violence Protection Act, Brittany's Law.
Also related to the first two bills on the agenda.
Move the bill.
Any other questions or comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Nay.
Senator Krueger.
I'm without rec. Yeah.
Senator Hoylman, without rec. Senator Kaminsky, Senator Squadron, and myself. The bill is referred to finance. 2630, Senator Lanza, that's me.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to dissemination of false information about a missing child.
Move the bill.
Questions, comments? All those in favor? Any opposed? Without rec, the bill is moved. 2631, my bill.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to establishing the crime of larceny of a controlled substance.
Questions, comments? Senator Squadron.
Under current law, what would the penalty be? Because I mean, I know this is the provision here, it's a serious crime, but you know, it's got to already be a pretty serious crime.
It would depend on
the
circumstances.
So the law is vague. There's nothing very specific with respect to controlled substances, so it would be based upon the value, it would be based on how it was taken, it would be based on what the amount of the drugs is, and somehow that might hook it back and tie it back into the controlled substance section of the penal law, so it's vague. There's nothing really specific, which is why I thought it would be a good idea to present this bill.
And what's the lowest level felony in this bill?
I think it's an E. You can look.
And there's no threshold for the...
Correct. Right?
Move the bill.
So, you know, I'm going to go without rec. I understand what's happening there. I think there's a lot of large parts of this with the bill. The felonies without any thresholds are, you know, generally concerning because, you know, you can capture that kind of one-timer. And so I'm without rec on that basis.
And by the way, there are certain provisions in the health law regarding possession of prescription drugs without having a prescription. And so there are a whole bunch of different laws swirling around this issue. Anyway, Senator Krueger.
Thank you. The middle of the day will find something very funny, but I'm not sure what part of this discussion. So, this
bill,
so this bill, or the example given in the memo, is robbing pharmacies of controlled substance. And even these references that people who steal prescription drugs from pharmacies are often addicts. So they are stealing for their own use as opposed to stealing for resale. But as I read the penalties of the bill, this would then be a scenario where we are increasing jail time for addicts as opposed to a new substance stream for major dealers, and I'm just curious whether it's inconsistent with other laws that we already have on the books that recognize addiction as something, A, that needs to be treated, and B, where jail doesn't actually seem to be an effective solution, and are we sort of moving one category of crime into a different category
I understand your point, Senator Krueger. I think what we see out there across the state is that while some of the people that are stealing these drugs from pharmacies and, by the way, hospitals and emergency rooms, some is based upon them, their own addiction, but many of these cases, because these are where there are large, obviously, quantities of these pills sitting in pharmacists, retail places, and more than even pharmacies, hospitals. And we've seen a rash of cases over the years where people have access to those, steal large quantities of pills, hundreds of pills at a time, and that is so that they can put them out on the street and sell them at the street level. And so that, based on many incidences across the state of these things occurring, that is what this bill is meant to address.
Although a threshold would help.
And
it would.
So in some of our other laws, there's a difference between proving the intent that it was for sale versus the intent of using yourself. Is there something in this bill that allows judicial discretion to recognize whether, in fact, this was an addict grabbing pills in an emergency room versus somebody who, you know, plotted to steal the drugs from a pharmacy
pool? I don't believe there is, and it's been suggested that perhaps a threshold ought to be one of the part of this bill, something that I'll certainly look into in terms of whether or not we take a look at doing something like that. But I think as it stands, this bill seeks to address this very dangerous situation that we see playing out in our communities, which is we have large stores of these pills. There are people that have access to them, and they're getting at them and putting them on the streets. But I'll certainly look into whether or not it would make more sense to address your concerns that we include a threshold provision in this bill.
So, one, thank you for looking at that. Two, I will go without rec. And three, if in fact we're seeing this pattern through emergency rooms and pharmacies throughout the state, perhaps, I don't know whether it's for this committee, but perhaps we ought to be looking into strict requirements for the storage of drugs both in our emergency rooms and our pharmacies to avoid these kinds of activities.
And I think that's a good point. I think actually hospitals and pharmacists, given the times, have been reacting to what's happening. And there are different policies in different places, so maybe you can bring to this committee a piece of legislation that might better address that in a more uniform way. Are there any other questions or comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Would that
recommend?
Senators Krueger and Squadron without rec. The bill is moved. 27447, Senator Golden.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to certain controlled substance offenses.
Questions, comments? Senator Squadron.
Just briefly, Senator Golden, who is here. The weights of these preparations of compounds is extensive in the bill. Mm-hmm. Sort of what's the source of those weights related to certain penalties? Let's stipulate we all believe the heroin scourge is serious and we have to do more about it. Absolutely. How do we then determine the penalties around the different weights and the preparation of compounds in the bill?
That should be described in the bill according
to the law. But like the benefit and the cost, you know, if it's in the narcotics statute, then you know, we have a long history of it. We know we can disagree over the weights and the penalties are related, but there's a long history that I think also links to federal guidance, in fact, for narcotics, at least in terms of categorization.
We changed the laws in the Rockefeller drug laws, but we never changed the weights. We should have changed the weights in the Rockefeller drug laws back in 2010. What we're doing here is catching up to something that should have been done 7 years ago. When we did ISTOP obviously drove the kids to the heroin because of the reduced price in heroin and the breakdown of fentanyl. So the weights of fentanyl and the heroin are increased.
Right.
In the bill. It's targeting the heroin in response to concerns that heroin is so light that prosecutors and law enforcement have been unable to charge what they feel is appropriate based on how light heroin is and the increase in heroin use.
At the federal level, you know, at one point during a moment of real panic around crack cocaine, which also happened to be used overwhelmingly in lower income communities and communities of color, was charged at 10 times the penalty structure that powder cocaine was, which, you know, I think actually it was fixed or started to be improved in a bipartisan way 2 decades later because there was no science behind it, no relationship to it. And so I have no idea if that's what's happening here, to be clear, but to just create a whole new penalty structure and throw weights in when we know the history is concerned, and actually was sort of hoping there would be some basis. In fact, I'm going to vote without rec on this bill in based on the assumption that this bill does have some basis for these weights, you know, stronger than we saw the capricious one that governed federal crack and cocaine statutes for almost 20 years, and by that I'm going to get the floor.
One of the reasons we did this is because the weight factor that they weights here are appropriate to the description of the law that we have written, and that is 9 people killed in Staten Island in 10 days before the heroin overdose. Think about what I just said. 9 people, 10 days, recently. Think about that. That's not one person in this room that hasn't gone to a wake or funeral of a young man or woman in this great state. And it's a reason for that, because the weight in the heroin and the fentanyl, when they take that and cut that together, the fentanyl, is killing these children. We gotta stop it. And the weight is taken into consideration of the structure of the law.
You convinced me to vote yes in committee, although I still think before this bill passes the House, we should know where the weights come from so that it can be enforced in a real way. And it's not a talking point, but it's a way to get at this problem at its core.
Any other questions or comments? I just wanna make a note. With respect to the comment that was made by my good friend and colleague about ISTOP, I think all the evidence out there controverts the notion that ISTOP had anything to do with moving people from pills to street heroin. In fact, in states that there is no provision like ISTOP, we see the trend even greater. What has happened, the anatomy of this is what happens, is the pills are more readily available. Someone gets hooked on the pills and the pill supply runs out, and the heroin supply, of course, is just omnipotent in the streets.
The dear chairman of this great committee, I beg to differ. And the results of the deaths in this state is a direct result. You can't buy a pill today for less than $20, $30, $40. You can get a pill of heroin with fentanyl, $5 to $7. So I got to tell you, if you don't think there's some
So again, just one last point. So as the sponsor of the ISTOP bill, all the evidence.
I think I thought it was good, sir.
No, all the evidence, all the...
I didn't go far enough, yeah. Far enough with regulating fentanyl and
heroin. Oh, I'm with you. I think there's a good bill. I'll be voting in the affirmative. But there is this notion out there, and it's misguided, and it's not supported by the facts. And I think if an honest look at the facts across the country, wherever there is not iStop, you have a greater problem. And the problem is growing as opposed to subsiding. So that was one prong in the attack against this scourge. It has done nothing to direct anyone from one drug to another. If anything, and the intended goal in its working, is it's to dry up the supply of those pills so that people don't become addicted in the first place. But
we agree to disagree.
Feel free to continue the conversation.
Any other questions or comments?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Without rec. Senator Krueger, without rec. The bill is moved. Next, 3039, Senator Colucci.
An act to amend the criminal procedure law in relation to a problem-solving court.
Questions, comments?
Move the bill.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? The bill is moved. 3299, Senator Gianaris.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to including within the offense of vehicular assault in the second degree the causing of serious injury while knowingly operating a motor vehicle with a revoked or suspended license or while not holding a license or establishing the offense of vehicular homicide.
Questions, comments? All those in favor? Any opposed? Without rec. The bill is moved. 3538, Lanza.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to computer tampering.
Questions, comments? Senator Squadron.
Thank you very much. Another case where it seems like we need to update our laws, and I appreciate the sponsor's attempt to do that. Concern here is this will leave no misdemeanor option around computer tampering for prosecutors. I have been told before in prior years, and I know we are running short on time, that they could always go into a different offense. But when you look at the bill, which I think is actually thoughtfully written on kind of the different kinds of computer tampering and what it means, the idea that someone might do this but without the kind of felony intent, the kind of intent you would see in a felony, seems possible, and it seems like you would want prosecutors to have that tool. So the absence of a misdemeanor here has led to an unfortunate, a heavy heart, long-term opposition to this bill. The support of updating our computer tampering statutes in a way that preserves a misdemeanor option.
Given the havoc that computer tampering is causing across the state, it's hard to contemplate tampering that does not deserve a felony note. But Senator Kaminsky has reminded me that a prosecutor can always charge an attempt of a felony to get down to the misdemeanor level, so I think that's still available.
Just put a 110 in front of
it. Just put a 110 in front of it. There you go.
Why have laws relate to the crime? We should have generalized A's, generalized E's, and just let the prosecutor define it.
No, an attempt on the E is an A.
That's what it is.
Misdemeanor.
Yeah.
An attempt.
Right.
Yes.
At computer tampering.
Which is a hard concept to get your head around when you look at the definition of computer tampering.
Well,
any other questions or comments, Senator Krueger? By some definition, yes.
So some young children have these variations on smartphones that have certain things on them and not other things. Are those computers? I mean, is anything that has web technology a computer? So is any act without permission on any of these devices going to be a felony under this law? I have to say that cyber security issues, the solution to a whole host of different problems we may see. So one of the examples is if you are breaking into someone's online banking app, right, using a computer, the question is, should we be updating our bank property? You want us to say that's bank property. If you're hacking into somebody's Twitter account, is that a felony? It can be really irritating, but I'm just not sure that that meets the standard of felony.
But there's no standard of hacking in this bill. In this bill, you could just sit down at somebody's computer that isn't locked and type something in without authorization, and that's indeed felony.
That would also be a felony. So, I'm voting no, but I urge the sponsor to go back and think more broadly about the definition of what computers are, what kinds of activities might take place. That I really think we need to take a hard look at the whole concept of how all information flows at this point and what it means to be inserting yourself into those activities. So I'll
Thank you, Senator Krueger. It should be noted that the statute would require altering or destroying computer information with regard to what devices or computers and which aren't. If somebody were to hack into your iPhone, I would imagine that you would consider it tampering. And a lot of these things aren't felonies until they happen to you. And this is really serious business because so much of our society, our documents, our finances, our personal information is now stored on computer devices. We really do need, I think, to address what is happening out there. The bad guys know that as well, and they are accessing, they are hacking, they are tampering at an alarming rate, and they are costing citizens tens of millions of dollars in lost property every single year in this state alone. Senator Golden.
Mr. Chairman, like my heroin and fentanyl bill, I think that it's about time that we move into the 21st century with that bill as well as with this bill when it comes to computer tampering and government programs.
Thank you, Senator Golden. Thank you, Senator Golden. Any other questions or comments?
Anything else, Senator Golden?
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Opposed.
Senator Krueger, Senator Squadron, Senator Boylman. The bill is moved. Next is 3857, Senator LaValle.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to assault on Department of Sanitation workers and nursing professionals.
Questions, comments? Senator Golden moves the bill. All those in favor? Any opposed? The bill is moved. 5069, Lanza.
An act to amend the criminal procedure law in relation to procedures for taking an appeal from a court that is not designated a court of record.
Questions, comments? All in favor? Any opposed? Without rec, the bill is moved. 5665, Senator Savino.
An act to amend the criminal procedure law in relation to granting peace officer status to traffic enforcement officers and traffic enforcement agents.
Questions, comments? All in favor? Any opposed? Without rec?
No.
Senator Boyle without rec. Senator Krueger without rec.
No, I'm
Oh, I'm sorry. Senator Krueger in the negative. Any others? The bill is moved.
Thank you, my vote without rec.
Gotcha.
Without rec. Golden.
Finally, finally on today's code's agenda, 5690A, as in Andrew, Alcantara.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to the assault of a driver of a for-hire vehicle.
Questions, comments? In favor? Any opposed? The bill is moved. That concludes today's standing committee on codes. Thank you all for your attendance and participation.
Thank you. You're welcome. Look at that.
I should